August 25, 1939, the world woke up to the news of the Nazi-Soviet pact signed in Moscow, setting the stage for World War II. Assured of Stalin's cooperation, 6 days later, on September 1st, Adolf Hitler launched his invasion of Poland. England and France, allied with Poland, responded by declaring war on Germany, but did nothing militarily to help the attacked country engaged in a bitter, lonely struggle against the Nazi invader. Meanwhile, on September 17th, as stipulated in the Nazi-Soviet pact, the Soviet Red Armies crossed the Polish border from the east and delivered the final blow to the Poles from behind. At the end of September, the invading forces met at the Bug River and, with much fanfare in Berlin and Moscow, divided the conquered country between them, proclaiming that Poland had ceased to exist. Long, dark days of occupation descended on Poland in both sections of the divided country. How the Nazis dealt with the conquered people and what crimes they perpetrated is fairly well known and documented. But in this documentary, we present the lesser known experiences of several witnesses now living in Canada who, as children, met with no less cruel treatment at the hands of the Soviet occupiers. Deported from their homes in eastern Poland to prisons and Siberia's slave labor camps, then later, by an ironic twist of fate, rescued from the Soviet Union, they immigrated to Canada shortly after World War II. Here, from scared adolescents, they grew into adulthood and responsible Canadian citizens. Now, mostly retired and in their 70s, with their suffering never publicized, they recall the haunting memories of their early experiences and those of loved ones who perished in the vast territories of the Soviet Union and tell us of their amazing childhood ordeal.
I was born in 1921 in a beautiful village, Zalesie, near Chortkov, at which I was raised and attended school. On the 1st of September, the barracks that we were stationed at, which was the regiment of the 5th Infantry Division, were bombed by about 40 German bombers. Out of 110 of the students, 10 were killed instantly. So from then on, we started marching eastwards, probably towards the Romania. We reached the town of Kowel, which is in eastern Poland, on the night of 17th. And then we found out that the Russian troops were moving into Poland. So the captain told us that the war for us was finished, and he suggested that we, in pairs or two, three, go back home. So I teamed up with a friend from Trembovla, which is where I was heading, and we started marching at night. I almost ended up in Kozielsk or Katyn, because in woods we were waiting for the transport to the southern Poland, where I was born, and they didn't have any transportation, so at night, the following day, they pushed us to the end of the station, railway station, and they were segregating. There were machine guns on both sides, Russian soldiers, segregating to the left, which ended up in Kozielsk, and us two young guys said, you better go home.
Mr. Dombrowski, could you describe your first contact with invading forces on September 17th, 1939?
They arrived actually to the torture, town when I was born.
These were the Soviet troops?
Soviet troops, yes. First of all, they started robbing the stores. They called that we are a capitalist. Enter with the secret service and so I start arrest. Arrest my father, goes, the priest, and quite a few civil servants. And that's where they started, and so on. They arrested me when I was going to see my friend. I was just a young student who, watching this tragedy, my beloved country, they arrested me and sent me to the jail. No, in jail. That's what is beginning. Every day, sometimes for 5-6 hours at night time, they take me interrogation, asking me any question. What's the name of my contribution organization? How many people there? So I says, look, I have nothing to do with anybody. I'm not a member of any underground organization. They try to just go round and round. That's what's going for. For about 7 weeks. And now one of the, there was, in the start, tricked me, they was very polite. And after a few days, they started very rough to me. They kicked me. I remember the day now, but it was about 26, 28 hours. They were around here asking the questions, so they never give me any food, anything, I had to drink. I was dying for drink.
How long were you in the prison in Woods?
September, October, November, and on Christmas Eve, they put us on a train, in a couple of trains.
All the prisoners?
Maybe a thousand, maybe more. And I was one of them.
You were taken from the prison to the transport?
Yeah, transport, and took us to Kharkov. I remember the name, they call Peresilnaya Tyrma. That's the place where they, after, so they taking them to the sledging camp around in Russia, you know. That was the center of the deportation place, you know. The people was dying. They was dying there.
Escaping from approaching a German army, in the second week of the war, myself and my uncle left the hometown Krosno with a number of crowds of other civilians, and we are proceeding east, hoping that the Polish army will stop the Germans somewhere. On September 19, near the town of Brzeżany, we met Soviet troops entering Poland from the east. At the first, we thought they are coming to help Poland in wars against the Nazi Germany. But soon we saw them disarming Polish army units, separating officers from soldiers, and herding them into railway cars to send them to Soviet Union. With our escape routes to Romania, blocked and not able to return home, we stay with a Polish family in the village of Gaik for about 3 weeks. About the middle of October, early in the morning, the Red Army surrounded our village and ordered the entire population, perhaps about 400 people, including me and my uncle, to pack up. Then they drove us in army trucks to railway station in Brzeżany, where we were transferred into waiting train of railroad cars. A few hours later, they added some other 400 people from the town, the surrounding villages, and trains start to move somewhere eastwards into unknown destination. The problem with a train was like this, that when once they shut the door, that was it. The first time they opened the door was probably 3 days after they shut the door. We were crowded so much in this railroad car, there was not enough place to lay down. We cannot even sit all together at the same time. And there was very few men, mostly was women, children. There was quite a number of young teenagers like I was, and there was some old people. In the first week, the few older people die and a few children die. And later, during the second week and maybe the beginning of the third week, I would say another 5 or 8 people die in my car. And what happened to those people? They were throwing out of the car to some railway station.
My name is Genoveva Staran. Instead of telling you about my experience of life in the Soviet Union, I'm rather going to read my paper I have prepared for this purpose. My nightmare of exile in Soviet Union started on the 10th February 1940 and lasted over 2 years. I was already a teenager then, and although many decades of my life passed, the memory of those tragic times are still vivid. At the early dawn on the 10th of February, a loud knock and a shout in Russian, "Open the door," woke our family up. There at the door were Soviet Union soldiers entering our home by force. At once, my father was ordered to stand at the wall under soldiers' guard with the bayonet on the gun. My mother, bewildered and terrified, kept quieting us children, scared and crying. Read in Russian, we were witness to the Stalin's order that we have to pack our belongings and be moved to another province. There was no explanation why or where we were to go. They gave us an hour to do it. Soon bundled up against the cold, our family was ordered to two sleighs, waiting outside, driven by the Ukrainian neighbor. We have started to move, convoyed by soldiers, toward the railway station Zvinyace, 4 kilometers away. Our home was left behind and all what was in it. The railroad station Zvinyace was crowded with other Polish families in similar situation as us, taken from warm homes into the unknown to be sent to exile. They were all our friends and acquaintances waiting to be loaded on the waiting freight train. Inside the wagon, we had to take place crowded with other families on the two-tiered bunks. It was cold and dark inside, especially when the heavy doors were bolted loud from outside. I felt like being shut in a large coffin. Our transport at first was passing familiar names of station, which I was writing down in my diary. We were still in Poland, but after a day or two, we had to be relocated to another freight transport train with cattle wagons, and from then on, there were unknown station in Cyrillic alphabet. I have realized then, with horror, that we are really being deported to the Soviet Union.
I cut the door, you know, and 3 men arrived, you know. We were shocked. There were 4 children in our family, but since my brother was already in prison, there were only 3 of us. I was the oldest one in the family at that time. They told us to get up and to dress up and so on. And told us that my mother asked them, where are we going to? Then officer said to my mother, please don't talk that much, you better get up now and start packing because you have to leave. Mm-hmm. And they left, officers left, and the private stayed with us, and he said to my mother started to cry. He said, please don't cry, you know, because you have a little children and we are going to Siberia. Uh-huh. When my mother heard no Siberia, she was panicky, you know, and hysterical. You know? And he even he helped us to pack up, you know. And sure enough, a couple of hours later, the horse and buggy came to pick us up, and they took us to the train station, which we were loaded, you know, in cattle trains.
There were other people there?
There were lots of people. We were surprised to see, you know, all of us were close to 70 or maybe even more people in one car. You know? The friends of mine find out, you know, that I was going to Siberia. They asked the soldier to let me out, you know. They were really very persuasive, you know. Because he opened the door and he said, well, okay, you just go for half an hour, you can see your friends, and then you have to come back. I said, of course. After half an hour, I came back, you know, and he said to me, don't be silly, run away.
The soldier?
Yes.
That was a Russian?
The Russian soldier. He said to me, don't be silly, you're a young girl, and you just run away from here because you are going to Siberia, you don't even know what's going to happen to you. Mm-hmm. And I said to him, listen, I can't. My mother is there and two little children. If I'm the oldest one, if I'll go, what will happen to them? And he said, well, if you are so stupid, you know, so go inside. And he opened the door for me, you know. I came and my mother looked at me and she said, she was so happy and radiant, and she said, you came back. Like she thought that I'll really stay there. Well, and the life started again. We started moving. We were traveling, well, I don't know how long, maybe 2 weeks, maybe 3 weeks. Mm-hmm. They gave us some hot water or sometimes, you know, a very thin soup, you know, for us not to starve completely. Day and night all the same for us, you know, because there was a tiny little window bar with the bars around. We prayed a lot, we sang a lot. Children were crying, you know, there was no privacy anywhere, you know. We were all like kettles on the floor, you know, lying one beside another.
It's the 10th of February. They woke us up at about 4 o'clock in the morning, and there were two Ukrainian chaps and two NKVD, which is KGB soldiers with bayonets set. They barged into the house and told me and my father to stand against the wall. They searched us. We had, there were six children, young children, four, seven at night. And they gave us about an hour to dress up and take whatever they thought, take as much food as you can. Then they loaded us on a sleigh driven by Ukrainians, two horse sleigh, and took us to Ryshaten, which is the border town between Poland and Russia, loaded us in cattle cars. They locked us up in those cattle cars, no water. 2 days later, they opened the door and let one, and I was one of the guys that with a pail to pick up some water. During that time, the only liquid we could have was from the ice that was forming on the outside of the boxcars. The boxcar had two tiers of sleeping quarters, a hole in the floor for toilet use, and a little steel stove with some coal to prepare meals, and whatever food we had, we could prepare them.
Suddenly, bang, bang, bang on the door, you know. We open the door and there's two soldiers with their rifles. My mother froze, really. It was, I guess it was too big of a shock for her. Packing and etc. was actually left to me. I don't know but what to take. But those two Russian soldiers were keep saying, take everything, everything will be useful. He eventually loaded us into the railway carriages.
You were driven to the station?
Yeah.
Were there other carts? Neighbors you saw?
Oh yeah, carts? All that marketplace was full of horse carriage, so they eventually closed the doors with us.
How many people would be in your cattle car, the transport?
70. There was one woman started to give birth in the, so my mother told me to watch the wall.
We lived in Bolin, Radivivu, Kolobrodu, not far from Russian border. 1940, when Bolsheviks came in February, I was 13, when I was deported with my family to Russia, to Arkhangelsk Oblast.
In the Arctic.
In the Arctic, right up north.
My father was employed by the PKP, which is Polskie Koleje Państwowe, the railway system, in Gdańsk, where myself and my brother were born. We lived there until about 1934, when the Germans were getting a little too obnoxious. To 1939, the war starts.
How old were you when the war broke out?
When the war broke out, I was 12 years old. We managed to get to the city of Lviv, my mother's place of birth anyway. And from Lviv in April of 1940, the Russians requested our presence in Siberia. And at 2 o'clock in the morning, after given graciously 10 minutes, we were taken to the Yakutska Oblast.
Before the war, both my parents were high school teachers. My father was headmaster of a high school, and apart from that, he was officer in reserves. And when the war broke in 1939, he went to front, and after coming back, by that time Soviets occupied the eastern part of Poland, and he was arrested and taken to Starobielsk. And we all know what happened to those 15,000 Polish officers. They were all murdered. It was 13th of April 1940 when 1 o'clock in the morning they came, four of them, two in uniform, armed soldiers, two in civilian clothes. And they told us we have an hour to pack, and they took us on a lorry to cattle wagons.
And short after we crossed the Ural, the train stopped, they opened the door and say, load off, here is a beautiful country, here you will live. Очень прекрасная страна. And how this beautiful country looked like, there was a forest all around, and there was a meadow, yeah? And on this meadow, there was already 2 inches snow. The ground was not fully frozen yet. And they pushed us, not everybody, there were some sick people. Not everybody wanted to go out of the car on the snow. I mean, they were pushing us by force. And the offloading took a few hours. The train honk a few times and they went up, out. They told to us, okay, we will prepare our life here. Let's start to, they give us the shovels, they say, dig trenches. And we didn't know how to do it well, but they show us how to do it. They built a trench for themselves, about 4 feet deep, 3.5 feet deep, something like that. They cut a few trees. They put first the trunk across the trench, and over the trunk they put the branches, and they cover this by the snow. They push snow together and cover by the snow, and they make one trench a little wider in some place there, and they make a fire there, and they went there and see, here we live. It took about 3 days before all people have a trenches. The condition was so harsh that the children, small children, died. But therefore, with us, then in the trenches there was only children, let's say, from 2 years up or 3 years up. When we settled with the trenches, they told us, okay, now we will build the houses. Yeah. But there was no skill, there was poor material, and not too many really strong people to do the work, because there was very few men. It happened like that from this Gaik, most of people, they went to the military, the Polish army.
They put us on another train and start getting it to Kalima.
That train take you to your final destination?
No, they took us to Buchta Kanachotka, Ochotsk Sea. That's where that boat starts from, okay? And took us to Magadan. Magadan is the capital of Kalima, right? But on that boat,
it was a prison transport.
It was so many died. About another 5-10 miles we went through, and there was a big camp. Concession camp, one of them, you know, and then they put us for overnight. I think it must have been about maybe 40, over 40 degrees below zero, you know, and covered that all the zero, and I got another 500 miles to go. In that 500 miles, at least, 10, 15 camps, I spot on the side of the road.
That's the prisoners.
Yeah, that's all, there's so many. The song we were saying that on Kalima, there was 350 in camps. No. Because that was the place when quite a few of the anchor with the officer told me, once you get you there, you never get out. The tragedy of the people, unbelievable. They had no mercy. Would try to suck your last blood, and you had to work, and that's it. There was a replacement, and some very often the thousand, with so many died that they either on the 1,000 or 50,000, God knows how many was coming in and replaced them, and that's what it was.
What was the whole purpose of the Kalima camp? What were you doing there?
There was the gold mine. Yeah. And they were shovels, barrels, and that's what we were doing, you know, digging. There was food rotten, there were no medical attention forever, and that's what they were, 10 hours, 11 hours a day.
Underground? You know, or?
Yeah, under, that's what we were working for. You know, there were so many people, so many died.
When we reached Kotlas, a river port on Dvina, in province of Arkhangelsk, the river was hard frozen. In the waiting column of sleighs, we had to go further along the riverbed to our destination in the taiga. We were stopping at night at some places which had no names to remember, but at that time in our voyage, it did not matter anymore. It was end of February and severe northern winter. I don't remember much from that time, being very sick, but one incident imprinted itself in my memory, which gave me later strength and hope and wonder and belief in the mercy of God. I was already recovering from my illness, sleeping a lot, when one day I was awakened by my terrified mother crying while I was like in convulsions. Child, my God, child! Mother shaking me, but I was not in convulsion. I have a strange dream. Waking up, I called to my mother. Mama, don't cry. I'm not dying. I had a dream that the Holy Mother, Our Lady of Częstochowa, told me that we will all survive and that we will go free from the Soviet Union.
When we arrived at our destination, the place was called 158th Uchastok, which was our sort of a concentration camp. About a year and a half or so, the whole families perished. There were a family of Sikora, nine people died of starvation. Vish, eight people died of starvation. And there were months during the winter that the supplies didn't get through. We didn't even have bread.
And when we arrived at this Christoforo, Arkhangelsky Oblast, there were only two barracks, at least for us. Of course, grown-ups had to go to work.
What kind of work?
They had to go in the forest, cut trees down, because we were in that part of the forest galore. And ladies work on this blind railway line.
My father worked in the Yakutsk Oblast as a lumber man, of course. And during the winter, I think the unfortunate happened. He had an accident, the tree fell on him, he was hospitalized. And they told us, unless somebody works within that group of family, you won't be able to survive for too long. I think I was the chief provider for the family at the prime age of 13 going on 14, which you grow up pretty fast anyway in that situation.
Did you see many orphans, children, Polish children starving or conditions for
them?
Well,
we have seen a few dead people in our shark too, people that were of the true intelligentsia, the professors, people that could not adapt to menial tasks, you know, that couldn't go and cut the woods. And without the means of the survival, then unfortunately, during the winter it usually was very severe, they froze to death.
After almost 2 weeks, we got them to Kazakhstan, to Tavaljan. There was already trucks waiting, and they loaded us on the trucks, and they drove us another 30 kilometers to the village, or a collective farm, when we were supposed to be. And they dropped us off on the central, let's say, marketplace. When the official was trying to assign us to the different places where we were supposed to live, a little argument broke out. And after a couple of minutes, I realized that the argument is about my family. So I said, oh my God, what's going on? And eventually, a young man took possession of us. I was almost felt pleased. Oh my God, they recognize us as something special. You know, why he wants us? Normally they say, well, we don't want it. But he's seen the big bundle, he's seen the basket, he figured we're loaded. Later on we found out that he was getting married. And he wanted to get himself dressed for a wedding. And he figured that we might have something which would be useful to him. And he won, okay, so we went to his home. And in his home, there was his father and mother, himself, his sister, his new bride, and three of us, all in one room.
Well, we came to, as I say, to Kotlas over there, and they've unloaded us into big hall, which was used for navigation, transportation. And And there were thousands of people over there. And there was always somebody talking, moving about, because we were on a concrete floor, just given perhaps a few square meters to stay there. And we stayed there for a few days. And of course, they used to give us a bread, but that's about all. And after a few days, they divided people into different sections and took us to our final destination in Taiga.
What did you do there?
Yes, when they took us over there, it was the same as the old Tsar did, to bring the people, so there are some inhabitants in a taiga, and basically everybody did cut the wood, which was taken down by the rivers, and they went into the big sawmills in Arkangel. So all the time I worked in a taiga.
When we arrived at our destination, they just dropped us on the outskirts of a village, of a kolkhoz, and told us to find lodgings. So my mother left us with our belongings and went to find who would take us. And this was the very hard part. Nobody wanted to take a woman with three children, because there was my sister, me and my brother, younger. But finally, and my mother found a little hut out in the outskirts of the village, and the owner of the house, hut wanted very much to go to town. But anyway, my mother, I don't remember what she gave her, whether some of the jewelry, some of her clothing, and she sort of let us stay in that hut, and we stayed there for 2 years. And my mother worked in the kolkhoz, my sister worked in the factory, and I was staying at home doing all kinds of things and working sort of occasionally. I was 13 at that time. It was, I don't remember, either February or March, almost end of winter, 1941, when my mother was very, very sick. There came a moment there was nothing to eat at all. And there were only two solutions, either to go and steal or go to beg. And I went, I can never forget that experience. I went to beg, and some of the people there were very nice. They gave me some few potatoes, piece of bread. But few of them, knowing that my mother was so sick, which it was contagious, they shut the door at my face. And that was that's an experience that I, after 50 years, I cannot forget about it.
Ketukhovo. It was brought. In northern Kazakhstan. We were brought to sovkhoz. Mm-hmm. We were all forced to work, children and women. Mm-hmm. We're working on the fields. In the summertime, you know, I worked very hard cleaning the grain, sort of like, you know, pushing all those big buckets of grain into a machine, you know, lifting them up into the machine, you know.
Were you strong enough to do this kind of work?
Well, I wasn't strong enough. I was frail and hungry all the time. Since we didn't have that much to eat, you know, and we couldn't get anything, you know, in sovkhoz. So we were going with my mother, with the stuff we brought from Poland, to kolkhoz to exchange for food. So we, for example, for my brother's suit or my father's suit, we got a grain, mm-hmm. some grain or some flour. You know, and that was all our, that was our food, mm-hmm. you know, a little bit of potatoes.
In Siberia, I tried to go to sleep, to bed at sunset. Otherwise, I don't see nothing. And there was toilet outside. So they have to lead me because I was blind.
You were blind from lack of vitamins?
Yes, nutrition.
Okay. Tell us about what happened to your daughter.
My daughter...
How old was she?
She was 10 months old. There was sickness for children that they had cold, but we had no medication or no milk for children.
No medicine?
But mine was 10 months old. So she died. She had, I think anything catches with person if you don't have proper nutrition.
After the fall of France, Norway, and Yugoslavia, as the air war with England dragged on, Hitler turned against his ally Stalin and on June 22, 1941, invaded the Soviet Union. With Germany's army's swift advancement to the gates of Moscow, Stalin, facing possible defeat, readily accepted English Prime Minister Churchill's offer to join the common anti-Nazi alliance, of which Poland, along with England and France, were the original members. This unexpected development gave the nearly 2 million Poles held in the USSR a new lease on life. In London, Churchill personally chaired a meeting between Polish Prime Minister Sikorski and Soviet Ambassador Majski, in which the Soviet government agreed to revoke the Nazi-Soviet partition of Poland, and a new Russian-Polish cooperation agreement was signed. As a result, all the Poles held in Soviet POW camps, prisons, and labor camps were to be released and allowed to join the Polish army to be formed in the USSR under the command of Polish General Anders.
In 1941, Nazi Germany attacked the Soviet Union. There was a general so-called amnesty for Poles that benefited many Poles. How did you learn about the amnesty and how did it affect you?
Well, in the amnesty, I did not learn till after the war broke out. And I remember that at that time I was sent down the river. There was on the shore one of the people who worked over there, Belarusian, and he started shouting at me. So I stopped and he said to me, "Do you know what? Germany attacked us." And I almost fell into the water. So I knew that this will bring us a freedom.
Mr. Dombrowski, you were sentenced to Kolyma, where, as you said, nobody returns from. What happened? How did you survive?
I remember two limousine cars arrived with some ranking officers with a uniform. They stopped us for success. Look, they started reading. There was agreement signed in the Polish government, the Russian government, you people are going to be released immediately and you could join the Polish army in Russia. Or, if you wish, you could join the Russian army. But we get what they get you after Kolyma. You know, I'm no joking, the people was crying. It was something like a miracle, because honest truth, I myself and not only my colleagues, they never believed they would come out of it.
Came so-called amnesty Sikorski Majski at the end of 1941. We were told that we are free, we could go. So myself and my friend Rolczewski, we organized the transport to go south, where we told that the Polish army was being formed. So we hired a transport, a few cars, box cars, and loaded all families, and we started traveling south. We came to Fareb, which is on the river Amudarya in Uzbekistan. And we are put on barges to go near Aral Sea. A tragedy struck we had no food, and on one stop the prisoners of lagers joined us, and they came with lice and with the black typhoid fever. So a lot of people died during that time. I remember we slept under a steep pile of corpses, about 60 corpses, dead corpses on the barge, and we slept underneath that. During that time, three of my younger sisters, 1, 5, 7, and 9, died. We stopped, we won't stop on the shore, so we had to unload all those corpses, and we dug little holes, and my father made a little cross out of a tree, and that was then. Today, I would like to find a spot where my three younger sisters are buried.
And there, it was a question of bartering whatever you happen to have for tickets or food. In our case, it was my grandfather's gold pocket watch. And when I approached the station master and I said, I'd like to trade this, provided he can give me 4 tickets. And he was elated. He says, okay, Malczyszka, for that we're going to give you some 4 tickets. He was able to put us on the train.
And in 42, after the amnesty, we got our paper. Mother took time, prepared some dried bread for our journey, packed whatever little belongings we have left, and we went by train, and we arrived in Jangiliul, and we arrived 5 days too late. There was nobody left there. We were walking, the gang of few young boys came and took my mother's purse, and that was awful because our papers were there. And then the first time in my life came an awful feeling of realization that I was nothing. Anybody could kill us, anybody could do anything, nobody would care, nobody would fight for us, because of that, without that little piece of paper we were just nothing. So my mother, again being a very resourceful and strong person, went to the market, all of us went, and she thought she recognized the person. She approached him and she said, I don't want anything, I just want those papers. And he said, you can fish those papers from public toilet. So she did it, she washed it, she dried it, and we felt better.
After Sikorsky-Majski agreement and Stalin's order amnesty for Polish prisoners, we have been traveling from Kotla since November to the organizing Polish army in the Soviet Union. Unfortunately, in Buzów there was not enough room for oncoming transport of Poles, and beside that, the Polish army headquarters was going to be relocated to Uzbekistan. Our transport was ordered to move on. Our voyage was terminated in Uzbekistan when we were ordered to disband in the Fergana Valley near Margellan. My despair had no words to describe when we were brought to the Uzbek's cotton kolkhoz for the future help and given clay stable to live in. The Uzbek's family supported us with some handouts, but we were there destined to die from hunger. Till we have discovered a field of frozen onion, digging them out was probably what saved our lives. We ate them raw and lots of it. Soon we learned that there was a 9th Polish Army division in Gorchakov taking men. Father and Edward were enlisted. Later on, I have run away from the kolkhoz and joined the civilian camp growing beside. One day, mother brought Zutek to the Polish Army kindergarten at the time exactly when the order came to move out from the Soviet Union.
As the Soviet prisons and labor camps opened their gates to Polish inmates, The released, half-starved men, women, and children faced a new hardship: the terrible distances to the Polish Army recruitment centers. With their camps scattered over the vast territories of the Soviet Union and no transportation easily available, many had to trek the hundreds of kilometers of tundra on their feet. Scores of exhausted and hungry people died on the roads. Even of those who managed to reach the hurriedly organized Polish army bases in Buzuk, Bartoszewo, and Totskoye, quite a large percentage succumbed to diseases, and soon after their arrival found their final resting place in the fast-growing cemetery in the fields beside the new bases. The situation was further aggravated by the fact that, besides the men and women of military age streaming to the Polish army, a large number of sick children and old people also kept arriving at its bases, for whom there was no food ration allocated by the Soviet authorities. To save these Polish orphans and sick people from certain death in the Soviet gulags, the Polish command decided rather to share its own limited soldiers' food rations with the civilians rather than to send them away. The visit of Polish Prime Minister Sikorski, who came from London to the Soviet Union to inspect the new army and personally appealed to Stalin to increase the number of food rations, accomplished little. With the German advance in the winter of 1942 halted and chances for Soviet defeat diminished, Stalin appeared to be less willing to allow a large, independent Polish army to rise on Russian soil to fight the common Nazi invader. This restriction of food and supplies revived mistrust and made cooperation between the Poles and the Soviet authorities almost impossible. Finally, it resulted in the decision reached between the Polish Army Command, Stalin, and Churchill to move the Polish army from the Soviet Union to Persia and the Middle East. The British were in great need for Allied troops to guard their supply routes in the Middle East and to fight the battlefields of Africa and Italy, and welcomed the newly formed Polish army.
Mr. Dombrowski,
did you join the Polish army?
Oh, yes, I joined the Polish
army. Where was that?
That's in Tosk. In Tosk. So many land in hospital.
Yeah.
Myself, too. Mm-hmm. You know, listen, we were glad to get out after something. I don't care, because I had a diarrhea before they put us on a boat to go to the Caspian Sea, to Persia, and the doctor says, listen, you could stay here, you got the army hospitals, you know, over here, and it's a port, and you could stay for a few days and get better, we'll go to another, but he says, no, I'd rather die on that boat, and you throw me to the water, I'm not staying for anything, and I managed to get through, but quite a few was dying on that boat going out of Soviet Union.
Out of an estimated 2 million Polish deportees and POWs taken to the Soviet Union between 1939 and 1940, only 119,000 were evacuated to Persia in late 1942 and early 1943. Before the USSR borders were closed again by Stalin. With General Anders' army came a large number of sick civilians and ravaged children, including a few thousand Jews. Several thousands of soldiers were sent from Persia to England to reinforce the Polish Air Force, Army, and Navy units there. And the rest of the force was reorganized into the Polish Second Corps. From the Middle East, they were transferred to the battlefields of Africa and Italy. The children and the elderly were dispersed to several civilian camps established in Lebanon, Palestine, and even as far as Africa, Mexico, New Zealand, and India. There, the mistreated children and orphans were soon transformed into smart-looking students and cadets. However, as the defeat of Nazi Germany approached, they faced a new tragedy. The faraway Poland they remembered and cherished from childhood was again being overrun by the Soviets and occupied by the same Red Army who had deported them from their homes a few years earlier. Only this time, in the Western newspapers, it was not called occupation, but liberation of Poland by the Red Army. Remembering their own ordeal in Siberia and the gruesome reports in the world's press of the discovery of 15,000 Polish officers massacred in the forests of Katyn, including some of their own fathers taken as POWs by the Soviets in 1939 and murdered there, they shuddered. In the Yalta Agreement, Poland's allies, England and the United States, abandoned their country to Stalin. At the long-awaited moment of victory over Hitler's Germany, they were shocked to realize that they would never be able to return to their homes in Poland.